Right concentration forms the heart of the path. The other elements of the path serve two functions. One is to get you into concentration, and the other is to make sure you don't get stuck there. In other words, concentration on its own is a state of becoming. Which is useful on the path. If you didn't have this state of becoming, you'd be kind of wandering around in other states of becoming, where it'd be hard to see what's going on in the mind. But as the Buddha said, it's when your mind is concentrated, you can see the Four Noble Truths as they've actually come to be. And when it's not concentrated, you can't see anything at all. In fact, there's one place where he says concentration is a miserable non-concentration is a miserable path, or not even really a path. So the concentration is the essential element. It's only when the mind is still, stable, can it really see what's going on inside. As for getting into concentration, this is why you need right view all the way up through right mindfulness. Right view starts with conviction in the principle of karma, that there are good and bad actions that give good and bad results. Not only in this lifetime, but in future lifetimes. And there are people who really know this. It's not just a theory. And what's interesting about the way the Buddha presents this is that he focuses on two types of good actions to stress their importance. One is gratitude to your parents, and the other is generosity. That these things really do have merit, they really do have value. Now, the fact that your parents gave birth to you is not just a set of impersonal processes that just happen to happen. Or that you don't owe any debt of gratitude to your parents for having given birth to you, for having gone through all the pain of giving birth to you, and then finally raising you once you were born. There really is a personal debt there. And that generosity is one of the ways you pay off that debt. And it's also one of the ways that you interact well with other beings, and that you benefit from. The Buddha's attitude towards generosity is instructive. This reminds you that when the Buddha is telling you what you should do, it's based on a condition. After all, the Buddha didn't create you. You might say, well, who is he to tell me what to do? Years back, I was sitting on a course talking about the Metta Sutta. The first line in the Metta Sutta, this is what should be done by one who aims at a state of peace. So the teacher started out with that line. Immediately, a hand shot up. A man sitting in the class said, I thought Buddhism didn't have any shoulds. And then they spent the rest of the morning going back and forth over that one. Actually, Buddhism does have a lot of shoulds. You look at the Dhammapada. It's full of shoulds. But the shoulds are based on a condition. This is what should be done by someone who aims in a state of peace. The Buddha doesn't tell you have to aim in a state of peace or you have to want true happiness. That's your choice. But if that's what you want, this is what you've got to do. The nature of cause and effect is such that these are the practices you have to follow. The Buddha isn't just saying, well, this is what worked for me and it may work for you, but I'm not sure, so you've got to find your own way. That's not what he would say. He said, this is what works. And it's up to you to decide whether you want to follow that path or not. But if that is your goal, then you've got to do it this way. There's a passage where King Basenadi comes to see the Buddha, and the first question is, where should a gift be given? And the Buddha says, wherever you feel inspired. In other words, there are no shoulds there, aside from your own sense of inspiration, where you feel it would be well used or where you just want to give it. There are no constraints placed on the act of generosity at all. But then the king follows up with another question. Well, where, when a gift is given, does it bear great fruit? And the Buddha said, well, that's a different question. And this is where the principle of cause and effect does kick in. And it places its imperatives. You want to give to someone whose mind is pure, or you want to give to an institution where their people are being trained to purify their minds, i.e. the Sangha, if you want your gift to bear great fruit. So there are shoulds in the Buddha's teachings, but they're based on what actually works for the purpose of true happiness. But in terms of what you want to do with your life, there's no imposition at all there. It's your choice. So once you appreciate the principle of generosity, and you see that it really is worthwhile, you've started on the path. As the Buddha said, it's impossible for someone who's stingy to attain jhana, to attain any of the noble attainments. So you start with the principle that generosity is good and that your actions matter. And when you dig a little bit deeper into the principle of action, you realize, okay, it's your intentions that matter. So that's what leads to the next step in the path, right resolve. You want to avoid intentions that would make it difficult to get the mind into concentration. So you would learn how to go beyond resolve, being resolved on sensual passion, being resolved on ill will, being resolved on harmfulness, because all these things stir up the mind in a way that make it really difficult for it to settle down. There's a passage where a prince, Prince Jayasena, walking through the forest one day to exercise, comes across a novice staying in a little wilderness hut. He says, I hear that the monks, when they really apply themselves, can get their minds into a state of one-pointedness. Is that true? And the novice says, yes. And the prince says, well, explain it to me. And the novice probably knew the prince and said, no, you wouldn't understand. The prince says, well, I might. So the novice says, well, I'll explain it to you, but if you don't understand, don't harass me with more questions, okay? So the prince agrees. So the novice explains it to him, and the prince says, that's impossible. Nobody can get their minds concentrated like that. Gets up and leaves. The novice then goes to see the Buddha. And the Buddha says, well, what did you expect? This person is so immersed in sensual passion, on fire with sensual fever, being chewed up by his sensual thoughts. How would he understand anything like this? Something that has to be attained through renunciation. So this is why the Buddha has you put aside sensual passion, because it makes it impossible for the mind to get concentrated. And similarly with ill will and harmfulness. Because if you hold ill will for somebody, if you want to be harmful to them, as soon as the mind settles down to be quiet in the present moment, that's what's going to flare up in your mind, and you're going to get obsessed with those thoughts. So the Buddha has you resolve to put them aside. And then we want to act on those resolves, and this is where right action, right speech, and right livelihood come in. Some people find the Buddha's precepts too hard to follow. Other people say that they're not inclusive enough. Ones who say they're not inclusive enough say we have to be more responsible. If there's a precept against killing, you shouldn't be able to eat meat. If there's a precept against stealing, you shouldn't abuse the earth's resources. They make them bigger and bigger and bigger all the time, to the point where it gets impossible to practice them to some extent. Or in some cases it is possible, but the Buddha said it's not necessary to go that far. We're working on the precepts that help the mind get concentrated, which is why they go as far as they do. In other words, you don't want to act on an unskillful intention. And you don't want to tell other people to act on those intentions. As far as breaches of the precepts where you don't know what's happening or was unintentional, those don't count, because it's the intention that's the important part of concentration. And you want to train the mind in terms of its intentions in areas where you have some control over your life and over your actions. Okay, when you've created that context for the practice, then you actually get into the parts of the path that deal directly with right concentration. First, there's right effort, which is having the desire to get rid of unskillful qualities in the mind, i.e. the things that get in the way of concentration, like the hindrances, and then to give rise to the skillful qualities, like the factors for awakening. This is an area where desire is a useful part of the path. It gives you the energy you need to work on the mind and to realize that you've got to make choices. There are skillful and unskillful things that arise in the mind. You can't just sit there and watch them arise and pass away in a totally passive way, because that doesn't develop concentration. And then the next step in the path, the Buddha surrounds right effort with right mindfulness, surrounding it in the sense that there are three qualities you're trying to develop. You want to be ardent, alert, and mindful. The ardency, that's the right effort. Mindful, in this case, to say keep the body in mind like we're keeping the breath in mind right now. And then alert, to see what's happening, to see if you really are with the breath, if the mind is settling down well with the breath, and catching it when you've forgotten. You're trying to establish a frame of reference here, because it's these frames of reference that are the topic of right concentration. Mindfulness practice and concentration practice go very closely together on the Buddha's path. And then as you're trying to get the mind to settle down, you have to start evaluating it to see what works and what doesn't work. And as your frame of reference gets more and more solid, you actually get into the factors of jhana. So that's what you should do to get into jhana, if you want it. Again, the Buddha doesn't say you have to do it, but if you want it, this is what you should do. But then jhana on its own doesn't lead to the end of suffering. A lot of passages that say that people get into different levels of jhana. If they don't go beyond that, if they maintain it, but don't go beyond it, they end up going to different levels of the Brahma worlds afterwards, after they die. And then when they fall from there, who knows where they're going to go. There's one sutta that shows people falling from the Brahma worlds and doing really stupid things. They're so blissed out for all that time that they've forgotten that their actions can carry consequences. So this is why once the mind is in jhana, you've got to start applying right view again. Well, this time it's right view in terms of the Four Noble Truths. Looking for the stress in your activities and seeing where it's coming from in your mind. In other words, looking at things simply in terms of cause and effect, what's skillful and what's unskillful. So as we're meditating here, remind yourselves, okay, it's the concentration that's really what we're after, what we're doing right here. And everything else in the path is aimed either at getting us here, or else making sure that once we're here, we make the best use of the opportunity to really see things as they happen. In particular, to see this issue of how the mind is creating all this unnecessary stress all the time, and what can be done to put an end to it. Of course, if you only want to follow part of the path, that's up to you. Remember, the Buddha never forced us to do anything. But if you want the best results, this is what you've got to do.